Welcome back to Altium Academy. I'm your host, Zach Peterson. Today, we're going to be doing a deeper dive into one of the 1-minute design review submissions I received recently, and this design review came from Mike Potter. Now, this design was Mike's first shot at an HDI board, and he did a pretty good job, but there are some lessons to learn from this design, and that's why I decided to go into a deeper review in this video. So let's go ahead and jump in to Altium and get started, and we'll take a look at this design. Now this design is pretty good. It's based around the nRF52840 in the VFQFN package. Of course, we have used the nRF52840 in the chip scale package in one of the project videos we've shown on the channel. And in this design, he did implement some HDI design practices in order to help with the fan out coming out of the edge of the component. The design also had an antenna feed line, it had some differential pairs, and it had 6 layers in total, so you had some pretty dense routing on a small board. Now, the circuit design was pretty good. I didn't really see a lot to complain about in the schematics, just a few small points. But in the PCB layout, there were some issues related to via design and related to routing that I wasn't able to cover in the 1-minute design review video. Now, what I want to do is jump into Altium and take a look at this design, and we can do a little bit of a deeper dive and see what we need to do to fix this design up so that it's going to be compliant with IPC requirements and ensure reliability. So here I am inside Altium, and we're looking at this PCB. Here, right in the center, you can see the nRF52840. If I flip it over, you can see some additional components on the bottom side, as well as some contact pads for soldering some free wires. Of course, we have our USB connector, and we have some other components. So there's not much on this board, and it's pretty tiny. Here, we also have some fab and assembly drawings that we're going to look through, and then we'll also look a bit deeper at the PCB layout itself. So the first place I like to start when reviewing a board like this is, of course, in the schematics and then the PCB, but for this deeper dive, we're actually going to start with the fabrication drawing, because of course, the fabrication drawing is like a master specification for the design when it ultimately goes to get built. And of course, the issues that we're going to bring up in this PCB layout do relate to manufacturing the board. So here we have a realistic view on the first page of the fab drawing, and then we have our drill drawing. It's always good to include hole tolerance, whether it's a fab note or whether you include it in the drill table. And then we have a stack up drawing and some impedance information and some fabrication notes here. So overall, pretty good on the fabrication data included in this drawing. Now here you can see from the stack up legend that this is a Type 2 HDI design, where we basically have a single blind via going from a surface layer to the very next inner layer. We have a core buried via, and then we have through-hole vias spanning the entire stack up. Here the outer layer is pretty thin at 0.11 millimeters, or about 4.4 mils for those of you who use mils, and that is good enough to support either mechanically drilled or laser drilled vias in certain cases. So that's the overview of the stack up, and of course we have these blind vias, but when I scroll up to the drill drawing, here inside the drill drawing, I don't see any separation between through holes, core vias, and surface blind vias that are going from layer 1 to layer 2 or layer 5 to layer 6. So because we have all of these different layer spans, normally it's a good idea to create one drill drawing for each layer span, especially in a really dense board. Now, if your drill drawing isn't too dense, you could consolidate multiple layer pairs into a single drill drawing as long as they're clearly visible from each other. But of course, you need to then separate the different drill symbols into their different drill pair layers. And you can do that by adding a column that states the layer span for those different drills. Now, this particular design does use stacked blind and buried vias, so in that case, we wouldn't want to have multiple layer pairs consolidated into a single drill table and drill drawing. We would actually want to break this out to 4 different drill drawings. So that covers everything in the fabrication drawing. Now let's take a look at the PCB layout and see what we can learn about improving this design. Now here in 2D, I want to start by looking at the vias in this design. So if I zoom in here to the stitching vias, you can see here that we have some through holes spanning from layer 1 to 6, and then we have our buried core vias right here going from 2 to 5. So let's select the 1 to 6 via first. Here, you can see that these vias have a hole size of 7.87 mils, or basically 8 mils. And then we have a pad diameter of 12 mils. Well, unfortunately, that pad diameter is going to be too small for these through-hole vias. Now, in addition to the pad diameter being too small, if we just take a look at the stack up, we would want to check that the total thickness of that stack up is going to give us an appropriate aspect ratio for that drill diameter. Now here you can see that the total thickness is 65 mils. And when we have a drill diameter of basically 8 mils and a 65 mil total thickness, that is an aspect ratio of essentially 8:1. That is right up there at the edge of what most fabricators will allow in terms of mechanical drilling all the way through this stack up. And because this is a through-hole via, it would have to be mechanically drilled. You're not gonna laser drill that via. Some manufacturers will set the limit at 8:1. Some manufacturers will set it at 10:1. It's always just good to check with your target manufacturer that they're not gonna have a problem drilling a 7.8 mil via through a 65 mil substrate. Now, if your manufacturer complains about it, all you have to do is just enlarge that via diameter a little bit. Increase your drill diameter maybe to 10 mils. That's going to require you to increase the pad diameter as well, and I'll discuss that a little bit more in a moment. But for this design, that's okay if you have to increase that drill diameter for through holes by about 2 mils. All of the dense routing that requires a 7.8 mil via is in the VFQFN package region anyways, and you're not going to be able to fit a through hole there regardless. Now, we just checked the drill thickness for the 7.8 mil vias for through hole vias. What about the buried vias going from layer 2 to layer 5? Well, here you can see the vias from layer 2 to layer 5 also have a 12 mil pad, 7.87 mil diameter. And if you look at the total thickness that needs to be drilled, it is about, 55 mils. So 55 mils with a 7.87 mil drill diameter is probably going to be okay for most manufacturers. So I wouldn't worry about that one too much. And of course, the blind vias on the outer layer are going to be just fine. Your aspect ratio is basically going to be about 1/2. So that's perfectly fine for mechanical drilling. And if you wanted to, you could actually make the diameter of those drills smaller. And once we look at the pad size in just a moment, in fact, we're going to see that we might need to do that. So that pretty much covers everything we need to know about the drill aspect ratios. Now let's take a look at the pad size. So here you can see, again, we have a 12 mil pad on a 7.87 mil via. For a mechanically drilled via that's being manufactured to the highest IPC producibility level, this will still not comply with Class 2 products. What you would want to do is apply an 8 mil diameter oversize on these vias in order to ensure compliance with Class 2. That would then require that this pad diameter be 15.874 mils, not 12 mils. Now for these buried vias, again, that's probably going to be fine. As you can see here, we have a lot of buried vias in layer 2 to layer 5, and of course, those vias are pretty sparsely separated, so we really wouldn't have a problem enlarging that pad size on these inner layers. Next, what I want to do is take a look at the blind vias in the region of the VFQFN package, because of course, these vias are very important for routing traces out of that package. So here, if I zoom out, you can see where the nRF52840 is in that VFQFN package. It's right here. Here, when I zoom in, you can see where some of these blind vias are. You have a 1:2 transition here. You have a 1:5 transition here. And if you just kind of scroll through here in the rest of the package outline, you can see some other via transitions that have been placed using these blind vias. Now, if I select one of these vias, you will see here that the via specifies a hole size of 7.874 mils. So I congratulate you on being consistent on your via sizing. However, the pad diameter is listed as 8 mil. Now, of course, these are via in pad. This is basically a kind of mixed style footprint where you have some BGA type pads with a thermal pad that is attached to the die in that package. And these pads are actually larger than 8 mil diameter. In fact, if I just clear the selection and then I pick one of these pads, you can see here that the pad also has a size of 12 mil diameter. Now again, we have the same problem on these vias that we had in the other vias that we looked at spanning from layer 2 to 5, and then for those through-hole vias. Here we have a pad size that is much too small to account for drill wander, assuming that we're going to be fabricating these drills mechanically. If we're doing mechanical drilling, that drill wander has to be accounted for, and that is done by providing sufficient annular ring. What do you do in this situation where you have really small pads that are part of a footprint and you've already oversized your drill? Well, there are a couple of things you can do in this design. One thing you can do is you can just make those pads a little bit larger, right? You're free to do that. And as long as you don't violate the clearance limits to neighboring pads or to any traces that are being put around the pads, then you're going to be fine. You're perfectly free to take any of these vias and just add 8 mils onto the hole size. That would give you a 15.874 mil pad diameter, and then you can see here how that pad would look for this via. Now, unfortunately, you can see here that we already have a clearance violation as soon as I set that pad to the larger size. Here you can see the clearance violation is a 7 mil violation to the neighboring pad, or it's a 6.5 mil violation over here to the thermal pad. So we have a couple of violations to consider. Now, frankly, if you're doing an HDI design, a 7 mil clearance limit is actually pretty large. Normally you would be going down to like 5 mils or even 4 mils on a standard HDI design with one layer of blind vias. If you're going to higher density, like less than 1 millimeter pitch on a BGA, then you're gonna have even smaller clearance limits, maybe 3 mils or maybe even as low as 2 mils. Now, if I take this neighboring via and I make it a 15.874 mil pad diameter, what's the actual clearance that I'm going to have to worry about? Well, I can just go ahead and measure that really quick. My clearance that I would have to specify between these two pads would be 3.615 mils. So that's the minimum clearance that I would have to be allowed to have in this design in order to just place class 2 compliant drills into these pads using a 7.874 mil drill diameter. Now that's getting right up to the edge of what a lot of conventional fabricators can do. So what's a better option than just oversizing the existing pad? Well, a better option is to also reduce the size of the drill diameter. That could mean a 5 mil drill or a 4 mil drill. That might also require you to reduce the layer thickness down to something like 3 mils. This would be required in order to ensure that you comply with aspect ratio limits on laser drilling. Now let's just suppose we did a 4 mil laser drill and we oversized by 8 mils. Well, then we would have a 4 mil hole size, we would have a 12 mil pad diameter, and then of course we would be in the exact same spot we were in before, just with a 4 mil laser drilled via. Once we do this and we resize that outer layer to be down to 3 mil thickness, we're gonna have a design that can be laser drilled and that still has large enough clearances that we don't require an extremely advanced etching and imaging process in order to fabricate the outer layers. Consider doing this at least in the VFQFN region because you have a 0.5 millimeter pitch and frankly, going down to these small vias that might have to be laser drilled is a standard practice in these types of HDI designs. Now I know most of what I talked about in this video was the via sizing and the stack up and those types of things because they are really important for HDI designs. But what about the routing? What about routing all these IOs out from this package? Well, let's go ahead and take a look at the routing here, and I'll reset the vias to their original size. Here, if I just zoom out and we take a look at just the outer two layers, you can get a good sense of what's going on with the routing. So I like the way that this was done because you can see here, if I turn on just the outer two layers, I turn off the component layers, turn off some of these other layers, you can see here that the routing was done pretty well, especially given the fact that we don't have a lot of room and we're basically routing down into layer 2 in order to get all of our I/O out of this package. Here, if I put the focus on layer 2, you can kind of see how this was done. So there's really not a lot of signal routing on layer 1, which is a good thing in this type of design because, again, you have to route into layer 2 to even get these signals out of this package. And you can see how that's done using these blind vias. Once all these traces make it into layer 2, you can see that they stay on layer 2, and we don't have any broadside coupling or overlapping between layer 1 and layer 2 for any of these signal traces. And that's really good because that's going to help control crosstalk. Now, the other thing that's going to help control crosstalk is the presence of the ground plane. And if you can see here in the layer stack, you can see that the ground plane is on layer 3. Now, what is the distance between layer 2 and layer 3? Well, if we go into the stack up here and we go back to the main view, you can see that the distance between layer 2 and layer 3 is basically 23.622 mils. So that's pretty far. So what I would do is I would change this stack up so that you also have a thinner layer between layer 2 and your ground plane. Then you can have a thicker core layer between layer 3 and layer 4. Now let's go back and look at the vias. Would this affect anything with the via fabrication? Well, the answer is no. We have a buried via spanning from layer 2 to layer 5, so we're free to make that change to have the central dielectric be a much thicker layer while having the layers between layer 2 and 3 and between layer 3 and 4 be much thinner. That's going to provide much closer ground reference for our traces, and that's going to, again, help control noise and crosstalk and help with EMC. Thanks for watching this video, everybody, and thank you, Mike, for sending in this design. I know you sent it in a while ago, but we have just a huge number of open design review requests, but I definitely wanted to make sure to get this one into a longer review because it is a good design and it illustrates a lot of fundamental points about HDI. If you're watching this video, make sure to hit that like button, hit the subscribe button, leave your comments and questions in the comments section. If you want to have your design reviewed, of course, find me on LinkedIn, send me your design files or your manufacturing files, and last but not least, don't forget to call your HDI fabricator folks. We'll see you next time.